Good morning and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Graham Day is joining us remotely for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 8 in private. Item 8 is consideration of the evidence we've taken on the non-domestic rates coronavirus Scotland bill. Are we all agreed? Everyone is in agreement. Thank you. Now we turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the non-domestic rates coronavirus Scotland bill at stage 1. We are joined remotely for this session by the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, who is accompanied by Scottish Government officials, Sandra Reid, who's Bill Team Leader, and David Smith, who is the lawyer. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. As all of our witnesses are appearing remotely, I would be grateful if Mr. Arthur could make it clear if he wishes for one of his officials to respond to a specific point. Before I open up the sessions to questions, would the Minister like to make a short opening statement?
I would be grateful for the opportunity, Convener.
Please go ahead.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee, and thank you for the opportunity to participate remotely this morning. The aim of this bill is to ensure fairness for all ratepayers. Members may recall when I gave evidence on the 16th of November 2021 for the Valuation and Rating Coronavirus Scotland Order 2021, I commented that subordinate legislation could only apply to the period on or after 1st April 2021, and that to go back further would require primary legislation. The bill builds on that order and extends similar provisions to matters arising on or after 2nd April 2020 by ruling that the effect of coronavirus on or after 2nd April 2020 cannot be considered when calculating a property's rateable value or net annual value in the current valuation role. The significance of this date is that it aligns with the date from which the definition of material change of circumstances was clarified by the Non-Domestic Rates Scotland Act 2020. The bill provides clarity and consistency to ratepayers on this policy. Typically, material change of circumstance has been used to reflect either physical changes to a property, such as an extension or demolition, or certain major changes in a specific area, such as the tramworks in Edinburgh. The intention with this change in definition was to reflect recent case law and move to a three-year revaluation cycle by restricting the circumstances in which general economic factors can be regarded as being relevant to a change in valuation. Since the start of the coronavirus pandemic, over 40,000 non-domestic properties have been appealed on the basis that there has been an MCC. Given the timing, it is likely that these appeals were lodged as a result of the pandemic. The Scottish Government is of the view that economic changes to rateable values resulting from COVID-19 should be considered at revaluation and not under the MCC provisions, when the impact across all properties will be taken into account. This is a view shared by the UK, the Welsh Government and in Northern Ireland. This ensures fairness to all rate players by ensuring that any effects of COVID-19 are considered for all properties at the next revaluation in 2023, rather than through the use of the MCC provisions. The bill under discussion today provides that in calculating net annual values or the rateable value in relation to any property in the 2017 valuation role, no account can be taken of any matter arising on or after 2nd April 2020 that is directly or indirectly attributable to coronavirus. The bill does not apply to changes to the physical state of a property or whether a property should or should not be included in the valuation role. For instance, if someone started working from home as a result of the pandemic. While appeals have been submitted for over 40,000 properties for 2019-20, this is less than a fifth of all non-domestic properties in Scotland. And as the Federation of Small Businesses have pointed out previously, not many small businesses are amongst them. This may reflect our generous existing support package for small businesses, but it likely also reflects that well-resourced, professionally advised property owners and occupiers are more likely to know about material change of circumstances provisions and probably therefore to have appealed. Meanwhile, a number of large and multinational firms that have been largely unaffected or potentially even successful during the pandemic have made appeals against their properties. As was discovered during evidence sessions for the order, there is a disconnect between how COVID has felt to businesses and how it has impacted rents in the commercial property market. This is a hugely complex issue and the outcome is uncertain. It cannot be assumed that these appeals would be successful or their outcome fair. We believe that the right time for market-wide economic changes to be reflected is at revaluation. We have strengthened revaluations following the independent Barclay review of non-domestic rates to ensure that they more closely reflect market circumstances. Firstly, we increased the frequency of revaluations from 5 to 3 years and reduced the time between the tone date and revaluation. Secondly, with the support of your predecessor committee, we delayed the next revaluation by 1 year to 2023 and also brought forward that commitment to a 1 year tone date, which will be 1st April 2022. Both measures that have been universally welcomed by the business community in Scotland. COVID-19 has had a major impact on the economy, and we responded swiftly and on an unprecedented scale to support businesses throughout the pandemic. We introduced 100% retail, hospitality, leisure and aviation relief in 2020-21 and were the first government to confirm a full extension for this relief for 21-22. In 22-23, we responded to a key ask from the business community to prevent a cliff-edge return to full liability on 31st March 2022. For businesses in the retail, leisure and hospitality sectors, we are continuing relief at 50% for the first 3 months of 2022-23, capped at £27,500 per ratepayer. Since the start of the pandemic, businesses have benefited from £4.5 billion of support, which includes £1.6 billion of COVID-related reliefs. We acted quickly to support the business community when it needed it most and continue to support businesses through the pandemic. Before closing, Convener, I would like to highlight one parallel development. As stated, over 40,000 appeals were lodged following the outbreak of the pandemic. The committee, when considering the order, previously raised with me the issue of workload around these appeals. Appeals lodged between 1st January 2020 and 31st March 2021 currently have a disposal deadline of 31st December 2022. This is the date at which all appeals lodged between those dates require to be heard. Valuation appeal committees require to provide appellants with a minimum 105-day notice period, and any request for a referral to the Lands Tribunal for Scotland by one party to an appeal, which is often used for complex cases, would have to be done by the end of June. While the bill will provide clarity for ratepayers, I have been clear that it does not remove the right of appeal. It will be for appellants to decide whether they want to pursue or withdraw their COVID appeals. As I am sure the committee will appreciate, appellants may not feel that they are in a sufficiently informed position to take such a decision until Parliament has finished its scrutiny of the bill. For this reason, we intend to shortly lay legislation to extend the disposal deadline beyond 31st December 2022 by one further year. In closing, Convener, I would return to my opening comments. that this bill seeks to ensure fairness for all Scottish ratepayers whilst maintaining the integrity of the non-domestic rate system, as well as the stability of Scottish public finances. And on that, convener, I will conclude and look forward to any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for highlighting the parallel development and your intention to lay legislation in that regard. I now open up the session for questions, and I would like to begin by asking, what is the main driver for this bill? Is it the protection of public finances or managing the volume of appeals relating to coronavirus?
Thank you, Convener. As I attempted to convey when I was in front of the committee in November last year, we sought to clarify the definition of material change of circumstance in the Non-Domestic Rate Scotland Act 2020. This seeks to further clarify what we mean by material change of circumstance, and that is the primary driver for the bill. It provides that clarity and certainty for the users of the non-domestic rate system. But of course, public finances are a consideration as well, and the financial memorandum illustrates particular scenarios and potential impact on public finances. And of course, were that to materialise, that would have to be factored into how we manage our budget year in and year out. But the key point, of course, I want to come back to is that fundamentally there is uncertainty about the outcome of material change of circumstances, both in terms of duration of appeals and any potential outcome and any potential impact that could have for ratepayers or indeed public finances. So, effectively, the reasons that I gave for the introduction of the order back in November apply to this bill. And I'm conscious that at stage one we consider the general principle of legislation. And I think in agreeing to the order that was before Parliament in November, there has been a recognition of that general principle of the need to clarify and be at and provide certainty around what material change of circumstances for, which is for clearly delineated local specific sets of circumstances, and that broader considerations around the general economy are best captured through revaluation, which is why we have a revaluation, maybe these changes to the revaluation process from a cycle of 5 years down to 3 years, and a tone date that precedes revaluation by a single year, ensuring that revaluation means that ratable values and the annual values are more reflective of the market at the time they're introduced. So I hope that helps to clarify what the intent behind the bill is.
Thank you very much for that. Yes, that's a very helpful clarification. Does the Scottish Government hold the view that successful appeals would be unlikely to prove effective in targeting support to those businesses affected by coronavirus?
Well, I think just given the unpredictable nature of it, there is no guarantee that any outcomes would be fair. And I think that's a point we can all agree on. I think the approach to supporting businesses that the Scottish Government has taken over the past 2 years of the pandemic has been one which has sought to focus on delivering support to where it is needed most. As I stated, we have provided in the region of £4.5 billion of support to businesses in Scotland. That is over £400 million more than what we received in consequentials from the UK Government. And indeed, as recently as December, we had announced a £375 million package of support in the wake of the Omicron variant emerging. And indeed, that has been delivered in tranches, the last of which was the £80 million of discretionary support that's now going to be available for local government to administer within their own particular areas. And I think that allows for a much more bespoke and tailored and needs-based approach to business support. With MCC appeals, it's not only a question of the unpredictability, but the timescales as well. We've been focused on getting support to businesses as quickly as possible.
Thank you very much for that response. I'm now going to bring in Graham Day with questions. He's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. When this committee considered the secondary legislation related to this, a number of stakeholders raised concerns about what they consider to be a lack of consultation prior to the introduction of that secondary legislation. And that was reflected in the committee's report. In fact, the committee sought to encourage the government to take the opportunity afforded by the bill to undertake further consultation with stakeholders around the proposed legislation. But we are told by some stakeholders that there still was no specific consultation undertaken in relation to the bill. And some stakeholders have raised the issue about the lack of a BRIA accompanying this. I wonder how you would respond to those criticisms.
Thank you, Mr. Day. As you will be aware, we indicated our intention to act on this in late June. That preceded the order that went before Parliament in the autumn. In that intervening period, there was extensive consultation, which my colleagues of Cabinet, Secretary Kate Forbes, my ministerial colleague Mr. McKee and myself undertook, where we met and engaged thoroughly with all of the major business representative organisations across Scotland. And as I think I remember certainly correctly conveyed at the committee, this was not an issue that was raised as a priority. Indeed, following that, of course, there was the consideration of the order in which Parliament took extensive evidence, oral and written evidence, which I was able to respond to in questions to the committee in November. So through that particular process, as well as the fact that we announced in our programme for government that we would bring forward primary legislation in year one, and I reiterated that commitment at a committee in November, we've been very clear on what it is we're doing. We have continuous and regular engagement with business, but I'd say in the intervening period between announcing our intention to act on MCC and the order being considered by Parliament, we had extensive engagement with the business community, and this was not an issue that was certainly, in my experience, raised in any meaningful extent.
So can I ask the Minister if you feel that the matters covered by this bill were covered in that extensive dialogue that yourself, Kate Forbes and Ivan McKee were having with businesses?
Yes, I do. They were covered. There was an opportunity for them to be covered within that dialogue. And the other point I would say is that given effectively what this bill is doing is effectively what the order that was considered previously, that taking the date back further year, 2nd of April 2020, there has been that opportunity for consultation and engagement, both in terms of direct engagement between ministers and business and representative organisations, but also importantly between the Parliament in considering that order. So I'm confident that there has been sufficient opportunity for that engagement and consultation to take place through that extensive process that I've outlined, both between government and business and indeed between Parliament and business. And I think that has provided to say opportunities for issues to be aired and to be considered. And I'm confident that there has, as I say, there's been that opportunity for business to feed into the process.
And what about the absence of a BRIA?
Well, I think it's just with regards to where we are, this is ultimately about clarifying an existing provision that is in place, which was within the Non-Domestic Rates Act 2020. So effectively what we sought to do with the order was to clarify what that provision actually meant in practice, and what we're doing with this legislation is effectively what we couldn't do through subordinate legislation alone is to bring the date back. And it's an important point to note is that the date that this legislation refers to, the 2nd of April 2020, is the date when that power came into force in the 2020 Act. So effectively what we're seeking to do here is clarify, and of course the Non-Domestic Rates Act would have was an opportunity at that particular point to consider all of the policy intentions there. Effectively what the order did and what this bill is doing is just seeking to provide greater clarity and certainty, which I would assume is something that would be welcomed.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Graham. I'm now going to bring in Paul McLennan with questions.
Thank you, Convener, and can I refer members to my register of interest. I'm a serving councillor in East Lothian Council. Morning, Minister. Morning, panel. Minister, one of the key things that's been raised by stakeholders is around about the retrospective aspect of the legislation. And it's, I know it's been mentioned by the Scottish Chambers of Commerce, CBRE, around about that. I suppose the question is, do you recognise the concerns of the stakeholders in regards to the retrospective aspect of the legislation?
I think what's important, and it's a point that I would think has a pertinence to the line of questioning that Mr Davies was pursuing just a moment ago, is that this legislation does not remove any existing appeal rights. So appeal rights aren't impacted. What it is seeking to do is to provide certainty and clarity around the definition of material change in circumstances. The policy intent was clear when Parliament passed the NDR Act 2020. And as I say, the order that we passed in the autumn and what this bill is doing is providing clarity. So with regards to being retrospective, it's not removing any appeal rights. What it is doing is providing clarity around the definition of what a material change of circumstance are. But of course, it is for an individual appellants to consider whether or not they wish to appeal or to renew the appeal or to withdraw their appeal. That doesn't change. This is just around providing clarity around that definition of MCC.
Thanks, Minister. And just on that as well, I suppose, I mean, would retrospective changes be considered again if the circumstances justified that? And would there still be the same approach? I know it's kind of hard to forecast the future sort of thing, but if that did happen again, would there be a different approach, a slightly different approach, or would this be considered again going forward?
Well, as I say, any provisions that are retrospective have to be given very careful consideration. What informs our approach to tax is our tax framework, which we published alongside the budget. I think that gives the best overview of how we would seek to proceed. And part of that is to have continuous engagement and dialogue, as well as being underpinned by the Adam Smith principles. So that informs our approach to taxation. As for any unknown unknowns and future hypotheticals, I wouldn't want to speculate other than to say that decisions around taxation policy are informed by and will be consistent with what we've set out in the tax framework.
Thanks, Minister. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. And I'm now going to bring in Megan Gallagher with questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and panel. And can I also refer members to my register of interest as I'm a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. Continuing with the theme of principles of taxation, will the Scottish Government's proposed approach go against the principles of certainty and stakeholder engagement? The reason I'm asking this is because committee has previously raised concerns regarding this, and I'd like to seek assurances from the Government this morning that these principles will underpin future settings of non-domestic rates policy. So can I ask the Minister if he could provide reassurances? Thank you.
No, I'm very happy to, Ms Gallagher. I say, with regards to consultation, stakeholder engagement, I've sought to address that in the response to Mr Day. With regards to certainty, this is at the very heart of what this bill is seeking to do. And so with regards to how we go forward, as I made reference to in my opening remarks, one of the key asks of businesses, the key ask around non-domestic rates ahead of the budget was to avoid that cliff edge on the 31st of March. And that is exactly what we did with the RHL 50% relief for the first 3 months. So between the certainty this bill provides, the engagement that took place between announcing the intentions and the order, and the current non-domestic rates policy for the forthcoming financial year, which has been informed by the key ask of business, I think that demonstrates that on engagement and on providing certainty, this government is absolutely committed to being consistent with the principles as outlined in the tax framework.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And now we're going to move to questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. You raised in your opening statement that you're aware of concerns that have been repeatedly raised around pressure on the assessor workforce. And we've heard in evidence of difficulties from the Scottish Assessors Association on recruiting staff to deal with the revaluation. And I just wanted to ask, Minister, if you think that assessors' offices are adequately resourced to deal with that revaluation?
I think on that question of resource, that helps to inform the decision when I made reference to in my remarks with regards to the legislation that we will be laying shortly pertaining to the disposal date, because it will help to provide, while providing the opportunity for appellants to consider the progress of this bill through Parliament and whether that or not that informs their future decisions. It also helps to address the issue of pressures that are being faced by assessors. So we're taking the approach, as I said, with the subordinate legislation that we'll be bringing forward, which to provide them more, to allow more time for appellants and users of the system to consider the position in light of how Parliament progresses the bill. But that obviously is a knock-on effect, will help to support assessors and freeing up resource, because I obviously recognise that we are coming up with our tone date in a few weeks' time, 2 weeks' time, and a revaluation process underway. So I take the point that you make regarding resource and capacity for assessors. That's why I took the opportunity this morning to inform the committee of the legislation that we'll be bringing forward, which will, as I say, two aspects to it, but one of which will be to support assessors in terms of capacity management.
I appreciate the Minister letting the committee know about that extension to the deadline date by a year. Can the Minister say if you think that will mean that appeals will essentially be smoothed out over that longer period and give assessors more time to deal with those appeals, or if you think that it will simply move the backlog date a year later and the assessor's office will still be feeling that workload pressure a year further down the line?
I think it's a fair question that you asked, Mr Griffin. What I would have to say, of course, is I have to recognise the independence of assessors and VACs as well in that regard. So ultimately how they choose to manage their workload, how they choose to proceed as a matter for independent assessors. Where we have sought to help is in moving, extending that deadline by a year. There's not no longer that statutory requirement for disposal by the end of this year, because, of course, as I made reference to in my opening remarks, while you have a deadline of the 31st of December, given the 105 days notice for citation, given the need to refer to the Lands Tribunal by the end of June, the deadline may be the 31st of December, but actually, we're only 3 months away, 3.5 months away from the end of June in that regard. So it creates more immediate and proximate pressure. So we have, by extending the deadline, seeking to give that, increase that capacity and space, so to speak, for assessors. But with regards to how they manage the workload and how the valuation appeal committees operate, that is a matter for them as independent bodies. I don't think it would be appropriate for me to say anything as a minister. It could be misconstrued as commentary on how they carry out their functions independently.
Okay, and just finally, just wanted to ask briefly, Minister, whether you've got any concerns over workload pressure to any appeals that would predate the 2nd of April 2020?
Yeah, I recognise that as a point that has been conveyed, I think, written evidence committee. I think the key point is that while I recognise these concerns, the key point with the 2nd of April date is to be consistent with what was in the 2020 Act. And the points that I've sought to make, I think, in response to all of the questions that I've sought to answer this morning, is that this legislation is about providing clarity and certainty. And so that's why it's very important that it aligns with that 2nd of April 2020 date that was in the bill. So while I recognise that there may be concerns, I think the reasoning and the rationale behind the 2nd of April date is very important, and that's why that date is within the bill. It's before us today.
Okay, thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your panel as well. Thank you for joining us. I wanted to ask a question with regards to targeted business support and just wondered how effectively support for businesses has been targeted in response to the pandemic. And what information does the Scottish Government specifically have on businesses which have fallen outside that criteria of support?
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. It's a good question. I think, I suppose, the heart of it has to, in answering it, has to be a recognition that it's not been possible to help every single business. And, of course, we are, to an extent, restricted by the mechanisms at our disposal for getting money out of the door. So one of the ways we're solving this is to address that is through the discretionary funding that we've provided to local government. And I made reference to the latest tranche of £80 million. Which local government will have discretion. I think that ultimately reflects a recognition that there is that local knowledge that councils have and can bring to bear in supporting businesses. We've also sought, you know, through other mechanisms as well, such as Scotland Loves Local Fund, to provide support for businesses more generally and in localities. But I think, I suppose, a key point that we come back to is we've had, you know, a total of £4.5 billion, £1.6 billion of reliefs were responded to the big aspect, key aspect of business, which was to avoid the cliff edge on the 31st of March. So it obviously it covers a range of the reliefs, you know, are specific, you know, have been delivered specifically through the MDR system in the last two financial years, which have been extensive. And obviously addressing the ask in the coming financial year to avoid the cliff edge. And then there's the various, you know, business support grants have been in operation across the pandemic. And then the final point is the discretionary money available for local authorities, as I say, in the most recent tranches, £80 million, which they'll have discretion in how they seek to apply to their own areas. So I hope that gives us an overview of the support that's been provided and how it relates to what we've done on MDR relief.
Thank you for that. It sounds like your postman's maybe arrived or something. Could I further to that ask, in terms of local authorities and handing down the powers to distribute that, what monitoring took place around that, specifically here in Edinburgh, for example, high number of hotel and bed and breakfast businesses, and how that support was then monitored to see that it would actually get into the hands of those most needing it for different types of businesses specifically?
Thank you. I don't have the details in front of me. We do, of course, we've published on the Scottish Government website our most up-to-date statistics on the delivery of resource. Of course, we local government provides returns on their spending for statistical analysis and monitoring from the Scottish Government. And in terms of how funding has agreed with local government through COSLA, the £80 million was subject to, you know, principles agreements about what was trying to be achieved there. So whether it be through the publications on overall business support, monitoring returns from local government, or the principles agreements that we have with COSLA in allocating funding, there's a range of ways in which monitoring, and as the point I think of driving at, Mr. Briggs, of ensuring the money gets to those who needs it, that we can evidence that.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. And I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. One of the reasons that our counterparts in the UK government decided to also not allow the appeals process based on COVID reasons was that they had put up a £1.5 billion business rate support fund, which, as I remember, was announced on the 25th of March last year, the day after this Parliament went into recess for the election. And Scotland's share of that support fund was to be £145 million. And this committee raised that issue several times over the course of the year, Minister. So it was just firstly to ask, has that money, that consequential, now effectively been received? And what are our plans to deploy it to support business in Scotland?
Okay, well, that consequential was contingent upon the passing of the UK Act, which has subsequently taken place since I was last in front of the committee on this matter. And that funding is included in committee as part of the budget process for the forthcoming year. What we have undertaken to do is not to wait, but to provide support in advance. So we had the $375 million of support that I referenced previously in Omicron. And the key point I would come back to is that overall, our spending on business support equates to £4.5 billion, and that's over £400 million more than we have received in consequentials. So even including the money to which you refer, we have went above and beyond what was allocated to us via UK consequentials and supporting businesses. And as I say, the most recent element of that is in terms of how it's been distributed overall is the recent tranche of £80 million to local authorities, which I touched on earlier. So we've not hung about. We've been working to get the money out of business as and when it is needed through a range of methods, whether that's been grants and support for specific sectors, be that wholesale or taxi drivers, but also through discretionary funding for local authorities, which they can then use to support businesses in their own area in a way that they think is most appropriate.
I appreciate that, but it sounds to me that that money is still assumed money, assumed that it hasn't been receipted yet into
the money has materialised as part of the budget process, but of course, it's without getting into the intricacies and the complexities of the budget process overall, we have found ourselves in, as you'll be aware, in quite a challenging situation. I don't want to draw any direct correlations between the MCC money and other parts of the budget because it's quite complex. But if you take, for example, the resources that we were anticipating at supplementary estimates towards the end of last year and then to the early part of this year, we have seen a situation where we have received less than we had anticipated. And then beyond that, we were led to believe that we would be receiving additional money to support cost of living, but we didn't receive additional cost of living money, and we had to find that the $290 million from that work from within money that we had already previously had committed, because fundamentally we've had a situation where the UK government has given us an indication of money that's going to come. The money is less, and then there's new commitments that have to be met from that particular money, which we had not been led to believe would have to be met from that money, i.e. cost of living. So, you take an example, we expect to get $841 million of subs. That goes down to $827 million, if I remember correctly. And then out of that, rather than getting $290 million of additional for cost of living, we've got to take that $290 million from that $827 million. So, this is something we explored the Finance Committee last week in spring budget revision. But it's just to give you an example of the complexity that's involved at this particular point of the year around the budget. That's sort of the key point I want to come back to, is that we have spent, we have delivered significantly more in business support than what we've received in consequentials, and we've worked to get that money out the door as quickly as possible and as effectively as possible to the businesses who need it.
Just finally, until that is finally clarified or otherwise, I presume the Scottish Government will continue to press for that consequential to be transferred to Scotland.
Well, just to be clear, the consequential, as I understand it, has been it was contingent upon the bill passing. That consequential has now been transferred and it has been incorporated into our existing spending plans. So, just want to be clear on that, Mr. Coffey. The point I'm making overall is that we have a. It's important to look at the money that's made available to us via the Barnett formula. It has to be seen in a broader context. But there's always, with Barnett, you have to look at what the net amount is. And sometimes there can be a particular budget line that's identified as increasing, but the actual net amount is reducing because of reductions in other budget lines. So it can create quite a complex set of circumstances in which to operate. The key point I'd want just to go and make is that that money has been received as part of the budget process, the key message I want to convey is that we have went above and beyond what we received in business support consequentials. As I say, we've spent £4.5 billion, and that includes, within the money we've delivered, a range of measures from tailored packages of support for particular sectors, from the 100% RHL relief that we had in the previous financial year and this financial year. We're delivering the 50% relief in RHL for the first 3 months of the next financial year to avoid the cliff edge. And we've also delivered that support for local government, £80 million for discretionary support as well. So rates relief, sector-specific grants, discretionary funding for local government, were delivered in a range of ways that we are above and beyond the resource that was allocated to us, including the MCC consequentials to which you refer.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Minister. Thank you.
Thanks. I think we have come to the end of our questions, so can I thank the witnesses for their evidence on the bill today. And I now suspend the meeting briefly to allow a changeover of supporting officials. We now turn to agenda item 3, which is to take evidence on the non-domestic rates valuation role, modification, Scotland, regulations 2022 from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. Mr Arthur is joined for this session by Scottish Government officials Anouk Berthier, NDR Policy Lead and Susan Robb, Lawyer. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Before I open up to questions from the committee, I now invite Mr. Arthur to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. This draft instrument under consideration today is purely technical and is intended to assist councillors in administering the Business Growth Accelerator Relief. BGA relief, which is unique in the UK, provides 100% relief on new properties for 12 months after they are first occupied, and 100% relief for 12 months on property improvements. In order to facilitate the identification of eligible properties by councils, the Non-Domestic Rates Scotland Act 2020 requires that the assessor put a mark on the valuation roll to flag new and improved properties. We keep all our reliefs under review, and in response to stakeholder feedback, BGA relief was expanded a number of times since the Non-Domestic Rates Act was passed. The draft instrument we are discussing today merely takes this into account and aligns the definition of new and improved properties in this Act with those properties that may be eligible for BGA relief from 1st April 2022. This will enable local authorities to distinguish the properties that are eligible for the relief. These regulations specifically clarify that property improvements include a concurrent change of use in the property, or where there are improvements associated with the installation of certain plant and machinery, including the installation of solar cells or solar panels. The Business Growth Accelerator is a flagship relief that has been praised by the business community, and it was even highlighted in response to the UK government's recent review as a policy that should be replicated in England. And I would note for the committee's benefit that the UK government have chosen to replicate it with a relief only for property improvements from 2023. As I say, the Business Growth Accelerator Relief in Scotland has been available not only to property improvements, but also to new builds since 2018. In fact, Convener, I will conclude, and I hope that members will support the instrument today.
Thank you very much, Minister, for outlining the purpose of this SSI. Do any members of the committee have questions for the Minister? No, no one has any questions. I thank the Minister and his officials for the evidence today, and we now turn to agenda item 4, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. And I invite the Minister to move motion S6M02982, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Non-Domestic Rates Valuation Modification Scotland regulations be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. Do members have any further questions for the Minister? The question is that motion S6M02982 in the name of Tom Arthur be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are all agreed. We now turn to agenda item 3, which is to take evidence on the non-domestic rates valuation role mod. Another agenda item. And I'm glad to see, Graham, that you have managed to join us. So thank you for that. The committee will publish its report on the instrument after the meeting. And I now suspend briefly to allow a changeover of supporting officials before we move to agenda item 5. We now turn to agenda item 5, which is to take evidence on the Local Authority Capital Finance and Accounting Scotland Coronavirus Amendment Regulations 2022 from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth. Mr. Arthur is joined for this item by Scottish Government officials, Eleanor Davies, who's the head of Local Authority Accounting, and once again, David Smith, who's a lawyer. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And before I open up to questions from the committee, I invite Mr. Arthur to make a short opening statement.
Convener, last year amendment regulations were laid in response to the financial pressures faced by local authorities as a result of the pandemic. The Scottish Government worked jointly with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities to identify ways for local government to address the funding pressure. The amendments sought in the 2021 regulations allowed a local authority to reduce the amount of any of the statutory repayments it was due to make to the statutory loan funds in either the financial year 2020-21 or 21-22, but not both. This would reduce the expenditure of a local authority in that financial year, thus creating additional financial capacity to meet COVID-19 costs. Given the ongoing challenges of responding to the pandemic, COSLA requested a further one-year extension to this flexibility to allow a local authority to reduce repayments to the statutory loan funds in 2022-23. Again, councils can only make use of this flexibility in one financial year. Most did not utilise this flexibility in either 2021 or 2021-22. But have indicated that they may choose to use this flexibility in 2022-23. Under normal circumstances, this is not something ministers would support. Requiring the repayments to be made in the financial year that they are due is prudent financial management. It ensures that both current and future taxpayers are charged for their share of the capital expenditure costs of assets being used to deliver services. But these are not normal circumstances, and it seems right to allow the flexibility to be extended by the amendments made in these regulations. However, we have made it clear to local government that this flexibility should only be used as necessary to address funding pressures arising from the pandemic and may not be used to grow reserves. The 2021 regulations also include a provision to ensure that future changes to loans fund accounting arrangements can be delivered through statutory guidance rather than requiring further amendments to regulations. This change, which was due to come into force on 1st April 2022, is to allow future harmonisation between accounting standards and statutory arrangements. In order to facilitate the extension to the loans fund repayment flexibility, these regulations also defer by 1 year the effect of this provision in the 2021 regulations. Separately, the regulations also changed the audit completion deadline for local government 2021-22 annual accounts, as requested by Audit Scotland, to address the continuing challenges as a result of the delay in auditing the 2019-20 and the 2020-21 accounts. Both Audit Scotland and councils are keen to return to the original statutory deadlines for 2022-23. In summary, convener, these regulations provide a financial flexibility that has been asked for by local authorities and will be welcomed by local authorities. The extension of the audit deadline will alleviate some of the strain on council staff, auditors, and that, convener, I will conclude and would encourage the committee to support the instrument.
Thank you, Minister, for laying out the purpose of this of these amendment regulations. Do members have any questions for the Minister? No questions. I thank the Minister and his officials for evidence today, and we now turn to agenda item 6, which is consideration of the motion on the instrument. I invite the Minister to move motion S6M02977, that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee recommends that the Local Authority, Capital Finance and Accounting Scotland Coronavirus Amendment Regulations 2022 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that motion S6M02977 in the name of Tom Arthur be approved. Are we all agreed? Agreed. We are all agreed. The committee will publish its report on the instrument after the meeting. We now turn to agenda item 7, which is consideration of the following negative instruments: Non-Domestic Rates Coronavirus Reliefs Scotland Regulations 2022. Non-Domestic Rates, Levying and Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2022. Non-Domestic Rates, Relief for New and Improved Properties, Scotland Regulations 22. Non-Domestic Rates, Unoccupied Property, Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. There is no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do any members have any comments on the instruments? No comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relation to the instruments? Agreed. Thank you. We agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next item in private, as we have no more public business today. And I now close the public part of the meeting. And thank you for joining us.